there was no language on radio, there was no Aboriginal people really on television, and very rarely there'd be an Indigenous person in cinema. But and then my mum and some of her friends decided that they desperately needed to start a media organisation, to start a radio station, so that information and education can be created, in a sense, so Indigenous people and communities can hear their voice, and hear their stories, and hear their music. We created a show called Greenbush, which was for all the prisoners in jail who could write, who could send, we'd go and get all their requests and their letters, and we would read them on radio and play the songs that they wanted, because that was it. A lot of the communities didn't even have telephones, so the only way people could have, get information across to each other with people like who were 500 kilometres away in jail, is to through this request show called Greenwich.
I think it's about 6:10 on Country Radio. Kenny here with the Greenwich Show, taking you through the night, with all your requests going out to all our mob doing time in prison. So give us a call if you've got any requests or any messages you want to send out to your friends and relatives in jail. Now here's a big cheerio from all the men in Block 4.
Technology, you know, technology changes, and you know, Indigenous culture has to change as well. If it's like the tree that blows in the wind, we have to move and change as a nation and as a culture to be able to survive. If we were stuck and grounded in that one little thing, and we cannot move out of our little bit of culture, we will die. So we change. You know what I mean? You will see an 80-year-old lady who's only met white people 20 years ago on Facebook, talking to friends, you know, because we change with the culture as well. Or an old man texting, you know, learning, but texting in his language, texting in Walpri rather than texting in English. You know, we have to, as a culture, we have to move and we have to evolve, in a sense. And ever evolve, or we will just die out.
You know, man, you're a fucking boy. Real men don't have their families. They look after them. Do you smoke? Told you before, I ain't got any. Well, fuck you, cut the phone. You want to come, brother? Come on.
Hey, turn it out, brother.
You know, radio became the informative for us. We could rally, in a sense, we could gather people through radio like we used to traditionally, and use it as a weapon or a tool. The other brother, she basically is the pain on our veranda in Alice Springs, which had been humbled by family and community, in the sense that our house was a bit of a respite for her, so she had these jungles, canvases, and just be sort of painting, you know, her yam dreaming and all that kind of stuff, and just be, you know, just having a great time. And you know, the curators would come and she'd swear at them and throw paint at them, and you know, and tell them to piss off and just keep painting.
My mama is an famous artist too. My mama paints the same story every time. She reckons white people's wouldn't know difference anyway.
But what is happening now is the world is getting more knowledge about what is happening to Indigenous artists in Australia, and they're becoming more wary of who they buy works off and what situations those artists are put under, in a sense, you know, almost like sweatshops to create these works. You know, lots of artists in one room painting and not allowed out, or you know, all they have is a cup of tea and a toilet, in a sense, and getting very little amounts of money for their paintings, and the paintings are being sold for large amounts of money. But then there's other places where, you know, they're actual co-ops where the artists own the gallery, and the gallery, so they get all you know, their works, they're nurtured, the artists are looked after because other artists are the people who look after them. The works are reasonably priced, and the artist gets most of the money back. And, you know, it's a flourishing situation.
Mother Courage is very much in the sense that tragic side and the most empowering side. You know, personally, I would say that, you know, she should have retired 10 years earlier, well, not 10 years, but, you know, she was forced to paint, in a sense, by galleries and by institutions, in a sense. But if she's going to be forced to paint, she's going to make sure that she gets what she needs out of it as well. And, you know, that was kind of the tragedy, but the empowering part. And I think Mother Courage, down in the park at the moment, is in exactly the same situation.
It's basically the same song line and the same journey as Mother Courage, the black play, but I've created an old Aboriginal woman who is travelling around in a van, and rather than going from war to war like Black's Mother Courage, she goes from Biennale to Documenta, and she's losing her children to galleries, in a sense, and to very bad art dealers who are, you know, locking the children up to paint, and she has to keep travelling because she's been forced out of her community by, you know, bad management and sort of, you know, bad poison in the land, in a sense, and, you know, the government's trying to shut down her community, so she's been pushed out, and the only thing that she knows is art and her paintings. So she's come to Documenta to show her art and maybe not be recognised, but to using art to survive as a survival technique, to eat, to live, to breathe.